This is Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, Senator Jack Martins is here to talk about community advancement, education opportunities, and saving you money. How are you, Senator?
I'm doing real well. Great to be here. Thank you.
Glad you can make it. The founder of Henry Viscardi School, he would have been 100, and I understand you and some community members got together to celebrate his vision.
Well, yeah, we got together at the school. We were invited. They had a ceremony. Henry Viscardi was a pioneer, a person who had physical disabilities himself. The idea that a child who has a disability, severely physically disabled, has an opportunity to go through a mainstream education was something that was important to him. So he developed a school. I mean, this goes back through the Second World War, post-Second World War. It's an extraordinary school. It's a model for other schools throughout the world. And essentially, it empowers children with disabilities, physical disabilities, to be mainstreamed, essentially have the same experience as we do in high school, graduate with a degree, and then there's a separate component to the school where they teach them life skills and the like to make sure that they will be able to provide for themselves as they go on. But it was all revolutionary. It was a new way of approaching persons with disabilities. Certainly at the time that Henry Viscardi was advocating for it, it was truly groundbreaking. And now we can all accept it as being normal and being something that we should readily include in our day-to-day. But back then it wasn't. So not only did he break ground, broke the barriers, created opportunities, but when you go to the school and you see these kids, I mean, we're talking about significant physical disabilities. Each one is individually cared for. There are individual educational programs for each child because of their disabilities. But that's what he saw, and that's what he empowered. When you go to the school, you see these kids actually succeeding, and with hope, it really is extraordinary. Great place, fantastic, and he celebrated 100 years, and I was very happy to be part of it.
It must make the parents feel really happy and the students themselves to overcome the disability and get a quality education.
Well, that's what it is. We have the opportunity to actually intervene earlier than society had historically done. So now they have an education. They have an opportunity to provide for themselves. They learn life skills, which is extraordinary because it actually, in the long run, societally makes a lot more sense. Rather than having a group of individuals with disabilities cared for and provided for their entire lives, we actually can empower them to become self-sufficient and allow them to provide for themselves, which is ultimately what they want, and ultimately I think what we want as well.
Yeah, very good. The Senate actually recently passed legislation to help kids in special needs facilities to make sure that they are properly taken care of.
Absolutely, it's part and parcel to the mission of the Viscardi School. It's important that we understand these children are as capable, as intelligent as any other child out there. They may have certain disabilities that provide them with special needs, but if we meet those special needs, they certainly are as capable as anyone else out there.
Yeah. Let's talk about higher education. The Senate passed a plan to make it more affordable for people. Tell us about it.
Well, one of the great banes of our existence these days is the high cost of higher education. You know, we keep talking about student loans. They project that the ultimate cost cumulatively of student loans across the United States is over $1 trillion. Which is extraordinary. When you consider that an 18-year-old, 19-year-old can get up to $200,000, $300,000 in student loans secured by nothing more than their potential earnings after they graduate from college, I think we're doing them an extraordinary disservice by not addressing this issue earlier, because people are coming out of college, and as we know, into a very difficult environment these days, with a tremendous amount of debt. and certainly that is no way to start off life.
Right.
The plan that we have would double the existing tuition tax deduction from $10,000 to $20,000. It would double the maximum tuition tax credit from $400 to $800, and would create the Stay in New York tax credit, which would be $12,000 over 4 years for those students who attend New York schools, graduate on time, and then stay in New York, which is something I think we should also encourage. Mm-hmm. Our young adults who are educated here to stay here. They're going to be the driving force for our economies for years to come. We should give them an incentive to stay right here in New York.
Right, and you mentioned graduate on time. That is really important. That's important for everyone, for the student, for the parents, for New York.
On any number of levels. If you look at the tuition that's charged for in-state tuition in New York right now for our SUNY schools, they are subsidized. And we recognize that they are. So to the extent that we can incentivize students to graduate within a certain time limit, we're actually saving money. Because the out years are a cost to the taxpayer. So if we can take that and funnel it back towards providing them with an incentive, providing them with a tax incentive, by using that money more effectively, I think we're all better off.
Right. Talk a little more about why it is so important to make sure that the workforce is filled with people who are educated and people who are educated in New York.
Well, look, first of all, we want to promote our own. Obviously, if we have children who've grown up in New York, we've made a significant investment in education through all the years. They go on to universities in New York. Certainly, we want them to stay here to help, you know, be our future, not only business leaders, but community leaders going forward. It's important. You know, as our population ages and as it becomes more and more expensive to stay in New York, it becomes more and more important that we provide methods to keep our young professionals here.
Right. Sousa Elementary School in Port Washington, I understand you judged a mock trial there. Tell us.
Pretty neat. You know, these are fifth graders participating in a mock trial competition, you know, plaintiffs, defendants, witnesses, cross-examination, objections, extraordinary, truly extraordinary. They were fantastic, articulate, poised. I was impressed, certainly, and I've said this before, children today are so much more prepared than we were when we were their age. And I would think so much more intelligent than we were when we were their age. And things like this provide the opportunities for kids to get beyond that classroom setting where they're constantly being tested. This requires that they think, they apply themselves, which I think really broadens the educational experience for our kids, kinds of things we should be focusing on, in addition, obviously, to the basics. But this challenges them to think outside the box, and I think it's great.
Yeah, and this this trial was something that they debated is something that they can relate to, and it was involving the parents of a young man who was injured and suing the producers of a wild, wackiest, crazy teen video contest. Yeah, so how did that go?
The fact pattern was interesting. Essentially, it was a TV program advocated for people to send in videos. And so the thought was that by their advocating people sending in these videos, they were encouraging people to go out there and do really dumb things. Mm-hmm. And in this case, a person went out there, did something very dumb, and injured someone else. And the question was, even though they did not do it directly, since they were encouraging people to provide these videos, should they be held responsible as well? And again, I'll after explaining what the theme was, these are fifth graders.
Yeah.
And they're having this debate, and they're articulating both arguments very well. It was very impressive.
Yeah, great way to think out of the box.
And frankly, my compliments to the entire school district, the Port Washington School District, the superintendent down through the teachers and principals. The fact that they have these types of programs in their school is it's pretty neat.
Yeah, I agree. Now let's talk about saving some people money. You have a bill to help people who use the Long Island Railroad not waste money for unused tickets. Explain that.
Well, you know, a few years ago, it went through relatively unnoticed, but the legislature changed the rules with respect to tickets on the Long Island Railroad and Metro North. Those tickets now expire after 2 weeks. So if you don't use the ticket after 2 weeks, they're no longer valid. If you're looking for a refund, there's a cost of $10 to get a refund. So if your ticket costs less than $10 and you happen to not have used it and you're going to use it, one, you can't use it if it's more than 2 weeks old, and two, if you want a refund, if you paid less than $10 for it, you can't get a refund because it costs you more to get a refund. You'd actually have to send a check along with your ticket in order to get zero back. It's crazy. It really is crazy. Mm-hmm. First of all, the 2 weeks limit is patently unfair. To put it into perspective, subway riders and metro riders, on the MTA bus and subway system, can be renewed up to a year. Long Island Railroad, MTA, 2 weeks. There is no cost for a refund on the MTA subways and the like. Here it's $10. Doesn't seem fair. Didn't seem fair. We put in a bill that would extend it to 6 months and take away that $10 fee. I think it makes a lot of sense. It's passed in the Senate. I expect that it's going to pass in the Assembly. And frankly, from a common sense standpoint, it's the right thing to do. You know, I had a person who relayed a story to me that they contacted the MTA and said, look, I paid, whatever, $7 for a ticket. I'm not going to use it. I want a refund. And they said, well, it's not worth anything because it's going to cost you $10 in order to get that $7 refund. And they said, well, what am I supposed to do with this ticket? And they said, either throw it away, give it to somebody, or try and sell it on the platform. Now, can you imagine people trying to scalp railroad tickets on a platform? It's absurd. Mm. It's not where we should be. It's not where we should be with mass transit. And again, it's a fairness issue, and I'm glad my Senate colleagues agreed.
I'm sure the riders of the rail will agree too.
I would think so.
Yeah. Pizza and Politics. Tell us about this program that you do.
Well, we go around to various schools, and we have an opportunity to sit with kids from the school and talk to them about current issues, things that are important to them. We do it with high school children. We do it with grade school children. It's a lot of fun. In this case, I was at the St. Bridget's School in Westbury. It was pretty neat. We had the opportunity not only to do a forum with their student government, which was great. You know, the perspective that these kids have. These are eighth graders right down to, you know, third, fourth graders. But they do have opinions, they do have perspective, and sometimes, you know, their opinions reflect that which is going on around them. We think they're young and they're not paying attention. They are. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards we had an assembly where, we had an opportunity to discuss topics affecting local schools, and they honored me with an honorary degree from the St. Bridget School. So now I am not only a graduate of the Corpus Christi Elementary School, but I guess I'm an honorary graduate of the St. Bridget School as well.
Very nice.
It was pretty neat.
So is this something you do around your district?
I do it, frankly, probably every week or every other week, whether it's with a grade school or a high school. Each one is different. Obviously, each one provides a different perspective depending on the community that we're visiting. I find that as you get into high schools and you have these meetings and discussions with high school students, older students, you deal with a lot of the more current issues that affect them going into college, a lot of issues that affect them as they're becoming, you know, young adults. As you deal with the younger kids, you're dealing with more general issues as to what's fair and what's not fair and what they think fairness is. It's great. It really is. Teaches us perspective, something we should always have.
Yeah. Thanks for coming in and talk to us about it.
Always a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Jack Martins. For any additional information, you can log on to the Senator's website, martins.nysenate.gov.